That you could join us this morning. Thank the Lord that that we have the ability to gather together in the way that we do. But on a day like today, I would so much rather us be together as we stop and we look at the 48th anniversary of Faith Baptist Church. What a huge blessing it is to be a part of a church that has a lengthy heritage as Faith Baptist Church does. So praise the Lord for that, and I'm going to say much more about that in the sermon this morning. You could be turning to the book of Joshua, and Joshua chapter number 4 is where we're going to be this morning. The history of the church is very important. The history of our church is very interesting, as I have learned and heard different things about the history of the church. It's been a real encouragement to me and a real blessing to be able to hear some things about the church and how things were started, how things have continued, different people in the past that God has used in our church. And it's definitely an encouragement, and that God has been doing that now for 48 years. That's impressive as well. So we praise the Lord for that, for the fact that He has worked for 48 years, and I believe is continuing to work and is going to continue to work in Faith Baptist Church, and we're going to see God do some great things. We are in Joshua chapter number 4, and we're going to read the first part of the chapter and the last part of the chapter this morning. Starting in verse number 1, it says, "And it came to pass, when all the people were clean passed over Jordan, that the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, Take you 12 men out of the people, out of every man, or of every tribe a man, and command ye them, saying, Take you hence out of the midst of the Jordan, out of the place where the priest's feet stood firm, 12 stones, and ye shall carry them over with you, and leave them in the lodging place where ye shall lodge this night. Then Joshua called the 12 men, whom he had prepared of the children of Israel, out of every tribe a man. And Joshua said unto them, Pass over before the ark of the Lord your God into the midst of Jordan, and take you up, every man of you a stone upon his shoulder, according unto the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, that this may be a sign among you, that when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean ye by these stones? Then ye shall answer them, that the waters of Jordan were caught off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord when it passed over Jordan, and waters of Jordan were cut off. And these stones shall be for memorial unto the children of Israel forever. Go down to verse 18. And it came to pass, when the priests that bare the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord were come up out of the midst of Jordan, and the soles of the priests' feet were lifted up unto the dry land, that the waters of Jordan returned unto their place and flowed over all his banks as they did before. And the people came up out of Jordan on the 10th day of the first month and encamped in Gilgal in the east border of Jericho. And those 12 stones which they took out of Jordan did Joshua pitch in Gilgal. And he spake unto the children of Israel, saying, when your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean these stones? Then ye shall let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry land. For the Lord your God dried up the waters of Jordan from before you until you were passed over, as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up from before us until we were gone over, that all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord, that it is mighty, that you might fear the Lord your God forever. I want to preach this morning the last statement in verse number 6 there, and it's speaking about when the children come and ask about what these stones are. They say, what mean ye by these stones? I want to preach that this morning. What mean ye by these stones? Let's pray. Lord, again, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for opportunity to open up your word this morning. I thank you for Faith Baptist Church and the rich history that is here, and the men of God and the women of God that you have used to establish this church, to be able to be around for 48 years. And Lord, as we stop and look at ourselves, at our church this morning for just a little bit, I pray that you would bless our time and we would be challenged by your word to see if we are doing everything that we can be doing for your glory. Well, thank you for what you do. We ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Well, this isn't probably an unfamiliar passage to you. And the memorials that are here, and as I stop and think about the memorials, I think about where we lived before in St. Louis, and there is a memorial, if you want to call it that, there. It is the Jefferson Expansion Memorial. You know it actually as the Arch. The Arch was the gateway, they call it, to the West. It's a memorial. It's a way to remember the passing over the Mississippi. They didn't do it on dry ground. The passing over the Mississippi for westward expansion. And they got a lot of history that's really neat behind all of that. And you can watch the videos of how they put the arch together and all that. It's really fascinating how it all took place. But it's there for a purpose. It's there to remind people. It's for people to go back and to be able to see the history. And still to this day, I don't know how many, probably millions of people every year go there. They go up in the arch, they go down below the arch and look at all of the stuff in the museum, and they understand a little bit about the westward expansion. The memorial is there for this, for them to remember. Wow, that's really deep, Pastor. I know. But that's what the memorial is. It's there so that you will remember. There's a memorial in this passage here that is to be set up. And as that memorial is set up, it's there to pass on to the next generation, that will then pass on to the next generation, that will then pass on to the next generation. Now let's bring it home just a little bit, and this is where we're going to apply this morning. 48 years of Faith Baptist Church, there's no doubt that God has done some amazing things. I'll mention a few of them as we go through this morning. But God has done some things. And as God has done some things, what do we do with those things? Do we just put them back in the file cabinet of our memory and forget about them? Or do we come and remember them and remember what God has done? Remember what God has done and He's going to do, because He's faithful and has done or has been faithful, and He will continue to be faithful. So how do we look at those things? You know, somebody had to take a step of faith. In our passage, Bible tells us in chapter number 3, in verse number 15, that the priest, when they came up to the water, they had to do something. The priests that were carrying the ark, the Bible tells us that when they came to it, they didn't just stand there and say, okay, God, go ahead and just move all the water out of the way, do something. No, what did they have to do? They had to take one step and they had to put their foot on that water. And the Bible says as soon as their foot touched that water, that the waters went back. The water stopped, and then they were able to pass over on dry ground. But it took a step of faith. Listen, the things that have happened at Faith Baptist Church, they have taken steps of faith. The beginning of Faith Baptist Church, it was a thing of faith. The people that were coming at that time, it was a thing of faith. They didn't know what the future would hold. They didn't know what was in front of them. They also had to take a step of faith, and praise the Lord that they did do that. But these priests, as they came up there, they had no idea what was going on other than what Joshua had told them by the mouth of God. You see, God had told Joshua that they were going to pass over the Jordan and they were going to be on dry ground. And so I'm sure that he would portray that, or he would give that message over to the priests so that they would know it and that they would understand what was about to come. But I mean, come on, let's think about this for just a minute. To do something like this, to put your foot out there, to take that first step of faith, to be able to put into the water, how would you like to be that priest? And the Bible tells us that the banks overflowed. Have you ever seen the force of water? I have seen the Mississippi in flood several times. And the thing that's always impressed me in flood is you can look out there and you can see whole trees moving, I mean just moving down that river. The force of that water. You see, they had to ignore all the force of the water and they had to go out and they had to take that one step. And they took that one step. And as soon as they took that one step, the Bible tells us that the waters went back and that they were able to pass over on dry ground. The same thing could be said about many things in our lives. We can apply it to Faith Baptist Church and the history of our church, but let's get right home here for a little bit and talk about our lives. Are we taking those steps of faith? Are we going out and stretching ourselves a little bit? I say this all the time, and it's not original with me, but sometimes God wants us to step out in faith. He wants us to get into a place that is uncomfortable for you and I, so that the comforter then will come alongside. You see, sometimes we do things in our own strength that God wants us to get to a place to where we realize we're uncomfortable and we need to be comforted. And so the Holy Spirit is there to help us through this. But let's go back to our text here. Again, in verse number 6, what mean ye by these stones? What mean ye by these stones? The children were to ask, they would eventually see these stones and say, what is this all about? Mom, Dad, what are these stones? I mean, they're stacked in a neat way. They look like they were there on purpose. This didn't just happen. Mom, Dad, what happened here? And then it would go on to say that you answer them that the waters of Jordan were cut off before the Ark of the Covenant. So we understand the reasoning for the questioning that's there. What mean ye by these stones? I want to look at those stones just a little bit, just three quick points, and then I want to ask you two questions. Three quick points here. The first thing is, I want to look at the value of these stones. The value of these stones. Verse number 7 says, then ye shall answer them that the waters of Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord. When it passed over Jordan, the waters of Jordan were cut off, and these stones shall be for a memorial unto the children of Israel forever. So in this verse here, that's the answering, how you would answer the children. How are you to answer the children? Well, you point them to God. You can go further, as we read in verse 22. Then ye shall let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry land, for the Lord your God dried up the waters of Jordan from before you until you were passed over, as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up from before us until we were gone over. You see, they were intended, this memorial, the stones, the value of them is that it's to point towards God. It's to show who God is and to show what God has done. It's the value of a testimony. to remind them of what God has done. You see, we have a testimony of things that God has done in our lives, and I hope we understand the value of that testimony, how important that is, that we have that value put upon the testimony of the Lord and what He's done in our lives. You see, this memorial was not because Joshua was a great leader. It wasn't set up so that everybody would come and say, "Do you remember when Joshua finally led us over the Jordan on dry ground? Do you remember that?" No, that's not what it was about. It was not about his leadership ability. It wasn't about how good of a leader he was and how good he was with the people and how he was able to be a strong leader and stand against people and to say, "No, this is the way that we're going," and would later on say things like, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." It wasn't one of those things where everybody would look at it and say, "Wow, Joshua was a great leader." No, it was there so people would stop and say, "Look what God did." That's the value of it. That it was all about God, and it would point people towards God, what He did. The history of our church isn't about previous members. It isn't about previous leadership. It's not about even previous victories. It's about God. It's about God and what God has done and what God will do and what God is continuing to do here at Faith Baptist Church. And we gotta put our eyes upon that, that it's about God, and it's about remembering what He has done and remember what He's going to do, as we read there in verse number 23, that He dried up the Jordan just like He dried up the Red Sea. I'll say more about that here in just a little bit. You know, when our church has testimony time that I've set up on the last Sunday afternoon service of the month, we have that testimony time. What is that all about? Is it about me to brag about something that I accomplished? No. No, it's to point to God. It's for us as a church, as individuals in the church, to say, "Let me tell you something about God. Let me tell you what God has done for me. Let me tell you what God did to me. Let me tell you what God did for me. Let me tell you what God did through me." That's what it's about. It's about God, and it's about pointing towards God. I also want to point out, when it comes to the value of these stones, that each stone of the 12 had an equal value. Each stone of the 12 had an equal value. You see, in verse number 2, it tells us, "Take you 12 men out of the people, out of every tribe a man." All 12 tribes were to go and get a stone and to take and to put over there for this memorial. Every tribe mattered. Every tribe would be represented, which would mean, really, that every person then would be represented. I see in this something that is so valuable and that is missing in so many today. When they did this, this was them identifying, not only is He my God, but this is also my nation. This is His nation, but it's my nation. They would say, "I'm a Hebrew." They would say, "I'm an Israelite." And they were comfortable in saying that because of God, not because of them, but it was theirs. It was their nation, and they were taking possession of it, saying, it's mine. And for these people in the coming weeks and the coming months, as they would go over Jordan and they would go and they would fight in Jericho, and then they would go on, and they weren't perfect when they went over, but God would even fight for them, and they would see some things. But you know what they would do? They would go in there and they would fight. And as they went and they fought together, they would become closer, no doubt. And as they fought together, the more they fought together, the more the nation, the more the people that they were a part of became their people. It was their nation. The same can be true about a church. That the more that we will work together, the more that we will invest together, the more that we will go to battle together, the more that we do those things, the more that it will become your church. I'm convinced of this, and I'm not trying to be mean, but I'm convinced of this. There are people in churches all across this country who go to churches all the time, but that's all they do. They go to church. When somebody asks you about church, what do you say? Do you say, "Well, let me tell you about my church"? My church. Or do you say, "Well, you know, I mean, we go to such and such church"? No, it's my church. I understand it's the Lord's church. I understand that. But listen, Faith Baptist Church, that's my church. It's my church. Why is that? Well, For you and I, it's because we're going to invest in it. It's because we're going to battle together. It's because we're going to work. I'm so thankful. We had people up here yesterday. I don't know how many people we had, but there was a handful of people. And don't worry, we were under our limit, I think. But we were working together, and I'm watching these people just serve the Lord together and doing things around here, getting things ready and cleaning some things up and doing some painting. And I thank the Lord for all those that were up here working. You know what they were doing? They were battling together. You know why they were doing that? It was their church. It's their church. It's my church. And I hope we all understand that. These people would go, and the more they would fight, the more that they would go to battle together, the more they would invest into it, the more it became their church. The value of this is that it would become then their nation. Each person, each family is important to the local church. Each person, each family, listen, is important to Faith Baptist Church. Everyone is important. Everyone has a great value. Is this your church? Are you willing to go to battle with your church? No, I didn't say, are you willing to go battle against your church? Are you willing to go to battle with your church? Are you willing to invest in your church? Are you willing to invest in the future and in what God can do and what God will do with Faith Baptist Church? Are you? The value of these stones. Second thing I want to look at is there at the end of verse number 7. It says, and these stones shall be a memorial unto the children of Israel forever. Excuse me. They will be a memorial unto the children of Israel forever. The permanence of these stones. They're a memorial forever. Here's the thing. You can't undo what God did. There's no way that they could undo what God did. God had just worked a miracle. God had just dried up the Jordan, made the waters stand up on a heap. You know, I've looked at language, tried to understand everything about what all of the terminology is when it comes to how the water was pulled back. And it just blows my mind. And the more I study it, the more I study it, the more I'm baffled because I don't really understand it. But I do know this, that they walked over on dry ground, that they were able to do that. You can't undo that. It happened. These stones are a memorial for that, that happened. This is a permanent reminder. It was a permanent reminder for God's people. Since it's a permanent reminder, there should be a telling of it. Again, verse number 22, then you shall let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry ground. Let your children know, it says. Let your children know. It's a perpetual reminder, not just a generational reminder. Now, you could read this passage and you could say, well, it means that they're supposed to tell their kids about it and that's going to be it. That's not the case. They're supposed to tell their kids about it. And then their kids are supposed to tell their kids. And they're supposed to tell their kids. And they're supposed to tell their kids. And it's supposed to be a reminder, a perpetual reminder, as it would go on through time. It's supposed to always be there. It should still be there today as a reminder of what God had done. A perpetual reminder. These stones were for the future generations to look upon and remember what God did. It's funny that we keep coming back to that point. But that's the whole point of this passage here, is to point towards God, that it takes us back to that place. You see, God worked a miracle. Can I tell you about Faith Baptist Church just a little bit? God works some miracles here. I love to hear the story of the first weeks before the church even met, and then when they met. It's a miracle of God that this place became a church and didn't become a bar. If you don't know that story, it's an awesome story. This was supposed to be a bar, but God intervened. Why? Because some of God's people got together and started praying and saying, God, you got to do something. And you know what happened? God did something. And as God did something, we find that that bar did not come in here, but you know what did? You know what came into the old restaurant that was here? You know what came into here? It was a church. It was some folks that just wanted to come and hear the Word of God preached. It was some folks that just wanted to come and praise their God. And God worked a miracle back then. And praise God that He worked a miracle. Do you know that story? Hopefully you know that story. Listen, share that story. And I don't want to embarrass anybody or call anybody out, but I was wanting to do something different to one of the hallways here. I've nicknamed it. Some of you have probably heard me. It's the Valley of the Shadow of Death. It's a narrow hallway. It's dark, and we're trying to work on things to change it. I'm hoping to maybe move it to where the widen it. But when you start widening it, you're taking away from everywhere else. But anyway, I digress. So I'm asking Mrs. Winslow, can you tell me about the original building? I'm wanting to know where the outside wall was, because I'll know that we can't move that wall. And so I'm talking to her about it, and I praise the Lord. You know what she did? She started telling me all kinds of stuff. She started telling me all kinds of history about Faith Baptist Church and in those beginning days of Faith Baptist Church and how they met. It would have been about a little over 2 weeks ago now that they had their first meeting. And it was one of those things where it was almost a spontaneous thing that they were all here and everybody was able to meet together to have a service together. And God worked and God moved in the way that they were able to acquire the building. And then you go on and you look at the many things after that God has done at Faith Baptist Church. But I thank the Lord for somebody that was telling me, that was sharing with me, telling me about these stones, if you will. Somebody that was telling me the history. And it wasn't about, here's what we did, tell you. No, it was about, it was amazing what God did. It was amazing what God did. And that's what it was about. Now praise the Lord for the miracles that were worked here. That's a permanent memorial. We can never undo what God has done. When I think about permanence as well, I think about this old book. Talk about a memorial. Talk about something that has a value, but also has a permanence to it. Listen, are we making sure the generations to come know this? Are we making sure everybody around knows the truth? The miracles, the working behind this book. I sure hope that we are. What a permanent memorial that we have even in the Word of God. What about your personal experience with Jesus Christ? That's a stone, is it not? That's something that's there as a memorial that you can pass on. You know, I shared with my kids at some point in time, I shared them about where I was saved and how I was saved, and thank the Lord for it, that there at Bethany Baptist Church in Lubbock, Texas, that God got a hold of my heart as a boy, a young boy. God got a hold of my heart. I was about 6 years old, somewhere in there. And I thank God for that. And I remember going down to the altar, and I remember talking to Brother J.D. Young, and I could take you to the exact spot. And you know what I did one day? We were traveling through, and I don't remember if we had stopped. I believe we may have stopped in Lubbock for something. And I said, we're going to go over to Bethany Baptist Church. And so I took my family over to Bethany Baptist Church. And when we got there, it was neat. They had changed things, and I was just kind of looking at a few different things around the church property there, and it was neat to see. But you know what I really wanted to see? I wanted to go to that place on the altar, on this side of the platform. And I pointed it out to all three of my kids and my wife, and I said, that's the place. That's where I knelt down with Brother J.D. Young, and I asked the Lord to save my soul. Listen, are we showing the memorials to the generation behind us? Are we making sure that they can see it? Are we making sure they know what God has done in our own lives? What has Jesus Christ done for you? The only way the memorial could ever be forgotten is if the previous generations did not tell. The memorial will be forgotten if we do not tell. And you know, that happened with Israel. And this is there's a statement that is said several times. And in one verse, just one verse that I looked at, Psalm 106:21 says, they forgot their Savior. They forgot God, their Savior, which had done great things in Egypt. they would forget about the great things that God had done. Many times we would find that they would forget about what God had done. Listen, if we don't tell them, our whole world will forget. The reason that our country has gone the direction that it has gone is because somewhere along the line, we stopped telling the previous generation about the stones, about the memorials that God had done. We stopped telling. And listen, if we don't start telling, you're going to continue to see a decline in our country. But Christians have to stand up and have to make sure that we are telling and that we are letting people know about what God has done. We need to tell people about the stones. What mean you by these stones? We need to tell them about God and the miracles that God does. We need to pass on things about our Savior. And then the third thing, the message of these stones. Well, I think we've kind of hammered this home, but it does get a little bit more centralized. It's about God, is it not? The memorial is about God. These stones are about God. But look at verse number 24. That all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord, that it is mighty, that you might fear the Lord your God forever. There's two different categories in this verse here. Message of the stones. What's the message of the stones? Well, first of all, there's a message to the world. That all the people of the earth might know. That all the people of the earth. That they will know that it was God that did this. That they will know that it wasn't Joshua. It wasn't the people of Israel. It wasn't anybody other than God. That they would know it. But look what it says. That all the people of the earth might know the hand of the Lord, that it is mighty. That they might know that my God has a strong hand. And they were to continue on telling about this memorial so that everybody would understand. Everybody would have a clear understanding about what had happened and about what God would do. The whole world would learn that God could even control all of creation. God had the ability to stop the water. If you go backwards in the people of Israel while they were in Egypt, the majority of the plagues that were brought on, the sorcerers, the magicians of the Egyptians were able to duplicate. They were able to do those things or something that looked like them. And so that's pretty amazing. But you know, there were some things that they couldn't do. And when I look at this and I see that that God had stopped the water, there is no magician that could do that. There is no amount of sorcery in this world that could ever accomplish that. God controls all of creation, and the whole world needed to know that. The whole world needed to know that God was the one that was in control, that God was the one that did it. And can I tell you that they found out? They figured it out really quick. Look at chapter 5 and verse number 1, and it came to pass when all the kings of the Amorites, which were on the side of Jordan westward, and all of the kings of the Canaanites, which were by the sea, heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of Jordan from before the children of Israel until we were passed over, that their heart melted, neither was their spirit in them anymore because of the children of Israel. Why were they so afraid? Because they understood the mighty hand of God, as we just saw. They understood the mighty hand of God. Can I encourage you in this? Tell the world of the miracles of God. Tell the world of the miracles of Faith Baptist Church. Tell the world of the miracles in your life. If you're listening today and you are saved and you know that you're saved, there's been a miracle take place in your life. God has taken you from a place that you were headed to hell and you deserved hell because you're a sinner, because every sinner deserves hell. He took you and he sent his son to pay the price for you. And that he died on the cross and rose on the third day, defeated sin and death and hell for you, and that you could accept his gift of eternal life. And as you accepted his gift of eternal life and you became a Christian, you became a believer, you understand this, a miracle happened in you. Because there's nothing that you could ever do to earn eternal life. All you do is put your faith in Jesus Christ. That's a miracle. What God did by sending his son is a miracle. Tell everybody about it. Tell the world about the mighty hand of God in your life. Tell the world about the mighty hand of God in your family. Tell the world about the mighty hand of God in every aspect of your life. Tell the world. Tell the world. But also there's a message here to the people of God. Again, verse number 24, the last part says that you might fear the Lord your God forever. Yes, it was a memorial to look back and to remember what God had done, but it was also to put things in perspective. It's this reverential awe of fear that's there. To reverence him forever. Exodus chapter 14 and in verse number 31 says, "And Israel saw the great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptians, and the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses." You know what happens when we fear the Lord, when we have that reverential awe of him? We then will start to believe him more. We start to see the truth as the truth and understand it as truth. There is a reminder in this, as I said earlier, that there is an importance of us making your church your church. But in this we see there's a reminder that he is their God. He is their God. You've heard me say it before. You can read through the Bible and you're going to find this. All God wanted was for him to be their God and them to be his people. That's all he wanted. Their God. Their God. And as this memorial was there, as they feared him, that he would become their God. You know, I'm really glad, and I there's a lot of people that I love that I know are saved, and I'm glad that God is their God. But can I just be selfish for a second? I'm really glad he's my God. I'm really glad he's my God. That he is a personal Savior. That I can know him on a personal level. What a God. What a God. But there's also an encouragement in this. Since he is our God, we can just keep on keeping on. Keep moving forward, as I mentioned, in the next days and weeks and months for these people as they would cross over into Jordan. There was a lot of things ahead of them. But as they would go, there was an encouragement to them. Hey, God just won a battle. Did you see what God just did? Could you imagine seeing the walls of Jericho just fall upon a heap, as the Bible says? I mean, just fall down into the ground? Could you imagine that? They would see that, and it would be an encouragement to do more. It would be an encouragement to continue on, to keep fighting. We must always look at things that God has done to prove to us that he's going to keep doing those things. You see, you know how I know that God is going to continue to work through Faith Baptist Church? It's because I can look back and see the miracles that he has already worked in Faith Baptist Church, and to see that he is behind Faith Baptist Church and that he is working in Faith Baptist Church because it's his church. And as he's working through his church, can I tell you, I know this for sure, that he's going to continue doing it because his testimony is that's what he does. God has proved himself, and so I can rest in him, and I know that he is doing that. If you ever doubt God, look back at the stones. Look at the things that God has done. If you ever doubt God, go back to those memorials. Two questions for you. What are we doing with the stones of the past? There came a point where they stopped telling the stories of the memorial in Israel. What are we doing with the stones of the past? Are we telling about them? Keep telling the stories of Faith Baptist Church. keep telling the stories about how God worked in Faith Baptist Church at the very beginning and even since then, how some things that God has done. Keep telling the truths about what God has done to you. Keep telling the truths about what God has done in your own life. Keep telling of God's goodness, but not just to those around you, but to the generation down the road, that they will tell the generation down the road, that they will tell the generation down the road. Listen, it seems that believers are thinning out. And can I say there's probably a good, I believe we can look back and have good evidence that it's because the older generations stopped telling the stories, talking about the stones. Could it be? I think so. I think there's a lot of truth in that. What are we doing with the stones of the past? And then lastly, you can turn over to Psalm 78. Another question. What stones are we leaving for the future? Again, to bring it home a little bit to Faith Baptist Church. What kind of things are we doing? Are we stepping out in faith as a church? Because if we're not, then we're not going to be able to have those stones. We're not going to be able to have the things, the mighty things that God has done. What stones are we leaving for the future? In Psalm 78, verse number 5. For he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children, that to generation to come might know them, even the children which should be born, who shall arise and declare them to their children, that they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments. I know I said this already. In this passage here, just to explain just a little bit what it's saying there is, there were some things that were set up that they were supposed to pass on to the next generation. And in verse number 6, you find that, well, and then they're supposed to pass it on to the next generation, their children, as it says right there. Why? That they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments. What stones are we leaving? You know, it's good to spend time with kids, and the phrase now is always make a memories. You know, you have to make memories with your kids, and you need to. Look, I'm not trying to take away from that. You need to go fishing with your kids. You need to play basketball with your kids. You need to. There's a lot of things that you need to do that are fun that you should do with your kids, and you're making those memories. But if you never do any of those things and you need to leave something behind, you know what it is that you need to leave behind? You need to leave behind with them a love for the Word of God. You need to leave with them the things that God has done, the miracles that God has done. I've shared with you a miracle that happened that I was a part of, that I was a part of the miracle. I got to experience what God did at United Baptist Church in Springfield. When we sold the property there, that was a miracle. But I tell you, the thing that I love about what God did there the most, we had an all-night prayer meeting, and there were several men there, but there were also some young teenage boys that were there. Can I tell you, those young teenage boys got to see a miracle, and they got to get this passed on to them. Look what God did. And I don't mind telling that story over and over and over again, because I want to say, look what God did, and to pass that on to the next generation. Say, hey, here's a stone right here. Y'all, look at this stone. Ask me what this stone is about. I'll tell you what this stone is about. And to have those memorials in our life where God has done some great things. Are we telling the next generation behind us about those things? Are we leaving the stones behind? You can invest in your children. You can invest in the younger generation by spending time with them and doing sports and all of those things, as I said earlier. But listen, if you're not investing in them in a spiritual way, if you're not leaving real stones that will last for them, if you're not doing, as it says there in verse number 7, it says that they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep His commandments. It's about God. If you're not leaving stones that point towards God, who cares? Who cares? What we need to be leaving is stones that point towards God. What kind of stones are you leaving? What kind of stones are you leaving? Your head's bowed and your eyes closed. Those two questions again. What do we do with the stones of the past? And what stones are we leaving for the future? Let's pray. Lord, I thank You that You have in my own life shown me You. And Lord, that there's some memorials there. There's some stones that are wonderful. And Lord, I pray that You would help us as a church, that we would pass on to the next generation who You are, what You've done, Your testimony, memorials to You, and Your goodness and Your might. And Lord, I pray that You would be with even the future of this church. Lord, the members of this church, even right now, that this would be their church because it's Your church, and that You're working and that You're moving, and they want to see what You're going to do and be a part of what You're going to do so that we could pass that on to the next generation. Lord, help us as we, again, look at 48 years of Faith Baptist Church. Lord, help us to continue on putting up those memorial stones and pointing to You. And Lord, individually, that each one of us would stop and realize we have to impact this world. We have to. You can use us to do that. And so, Lord, I pray that You would. We love You. We ask all this in Christ's name. Amen.